Greetings, everybody, and welcome to a promise that I'd like to keep to a number of people who made this request of me in the Old Hunters Let's Play. For which reason, this video is going to go in that playlist as an addendum, even though technically it's really more of a walkthrough. People have been asking me which chalice dungeons I use to farm the gems and blood rocks that I upgraded my equipment with in the Old Hunters LP. So I'm going to go through and answer those questions now. Please bear in mind, though, this is not a comprehensive or all-inclusive guide to the chalice dungeons. A couple of people have asked me for that. I just don't have the energy to spend that much time in the dungeons. I'm sorry, but I can't bear to. I'm so sick of those damn dungeons. But I did want to at least answer the question of where I got what I'm using. So what you're going to learn in this video is where to get the gems you're seeing in all of the weapons I'm showing now. The good news is that all but one of the gem types you're going to be seeing today are dropped by the same boss fight. The bad news is that unfortunately they do not all drop at the same rate. So depending upon what you're looking for, you may have a relatively short farm or a really miserably, unreasonably long farm. Now, one of the gem types that does not drop from this boss fight is this one, the Blood Attack Up plus 31.5% one. And actually, this is probably the easiest one to get because this is dropped by a normal enemy, which you can farm very quickly and efficiently. We're going to be covering that one a little bit later on. There are also a couple of other gems here in storage I wanted to show you because although I don't have uses for these are also dropped by the same boss fight we're going to be looking at today. And unfortunately, these are the extremely rare drops from that fight. So if you want that fire damage up plus 27.2% gem, or one of these arcane damage bonus gems with the same flat percentage, you're going to spend a lot more time than you would if you were looking for one of these, the radial or triangular cursed tempering gems that give you the physical damage bonus. The thrust and blunt ones are very rare as well. Those are also one of the rare drops from the fight. You can get the scaling gems from that fight as well, but the ones from that fight really are not worth using. The 27.2 scaling gems are worthless. There are only a couple of fights that give you scaling gems which are worth using. This one as well, the charge attack bonus gem, also comes from that fight, the same fight we're going to be dealing with today. And this, unfortunately, also is one of the extremely rare drops. So if you want any of these, you're going to be there for a really long time. The primary focus of this video is going to be the physical damage plus 27.2% radial and triangular gems. Now, the exact fight we're going to be dealing with is the three merciless watchers. I'm sure those of you who've done some chalice dungeons already are probably familiar with that fight. And we're actually going to be dealing with it in two separate dungeons today, because one of those dungeons gives primarily triangular gems, and the other primarily radial. My weapon of choice for this fight is the rifle spear, and you can see that I've got here gems which focus solely on boosting thrust attack damage. The reason for that is because I pretty nearly only use the charged attack in transform mode. And we're going to be going over the strategy, if you could call it that, for this fight. So the glyph for the first dungeon is 5PWUJSCD, and it'll give you a dungeon with these characteristics. I wanted to make sure I've shown this so that you know what glyph to use and what dungeon you're going to get out of that glyph. I'm also going to be taking you through each dungeon up to the point at which you'll have to do the boss fight, so you'll know the most efficient way to get to the switch, and hopefully this will help make farming these dungeons a little bit less painful and annoying. This is a cursed East Gravestone dungeon, so most of the enemies in here are going to be East-type enemies. They'll be small celestial emissaries, and the switch guard is going to be a Brainsucker. First off, you want to just head right in and turn left immediately. Run up the stairs. If you care about treasure, there's a blood vial or two back near the door. A ritual blood 5 here. But be very careful when you walk through this doorway, because there's a switch right there on the floor, which will cause those statues over there to shoot fire arrows at you. You don't want to walk into that and get killed by it, because it will kill you in one hit with the curse effect in this dungeon. And the switch is right over here. There's nothing really complicated to finding it. And you just off this guy, preferably with thrust attacks, because you can see there, the slash attacks from this weapon did no damage to him. These guys do not drop gems that are worth using, but if you have some need for the flat arcane increase gems, you can get them from a boss that I'm going to be showing a little bit later in the video. That's a better place to get them than from the switch guards here. You don't really need to use a Bold Hunter's Mark to get back to the switch because it's fairly close, but it does shave a few seconds off the clear time for this dungeon. So it can be helpful as well. Now, the most important thing, which I'm going to be discussing the technique for this at the very end of the video, but it's save scumming. And ordinarily, you would probably want to load your, or upload rather, your save data to either a USB stick or the cloud before initiating this boss fight, just so that you don't have to run through the dungeon all over again to get to the switch and have to deal with that if you don't get the gem that you want from the fight, or if the fight just doesn't drop a gem at all. But again, I'm going to be dealing with the save scumming technique for that at the end of the video, so you'll learn how to do it then, and it'll be up to you if you want to use it for these smaller fights. You're going to need it for getting blood rocks, and I will be showing that farm as well. But for the smaller boss fights, just for gems, it's more of an option. It's up to you. It does still save some time, so I still prefer to use it, but what I'm concerned with at the moment is just showing the farm runs themselves. Now, the reason I like the rifle spear for this fight is because its charged attack has such ridiculously long range that enemy AI actually does not know how to deal with it. And you can use that to hit these watchers from so far outside their range that there is absolutely nothing they can do to you. It's also an advantage to approach this fight from the upper level of this boss room, because the layout here from up top gives you much more cover from that dirtbag with the pistol. So the best thing to do is get the melee watchers out of the way first, because you can just block the pistol guy with the terrain and he won't be able to do anything to you unless you get really careless. I unfortunately did not get the tier 19 gem from this fight, but it does drop them. That was a tier 17 gem, I think, and this fight does drop tier 17 and 18 as well, so that's another problem. But the tier 19 gems will give you the 27.2% effect, and this fight will usually drop triangular gems, but on a very, very rare occasion, you may get waning or possibly radial. But there's no point in doing that fight for radial gems, because this next one will usually drop radials. This next fight is also going to occasionally, on a very, very rare occasion, drop waning gems as well. The glyph here is PWMF22GU. And this, once again, is going to be that exact same fight. It's going to be the Watchers, except that this time it's going to be a Cursed Thumero Ihyll dungeon. So the dungeon enemy types are going to be a little bit different, even though the boss is going to be exactly the same. Now, both of these fights can drop gem types other than the flat damage bonus plus 27.2% ones. They can drop both the thrust and blunt damage plus 32.6% gems as well, and that's actually what I was trying to get for my beast cutter. But they unfortunately refused to drop that gem, and instead I got two thrust damage plus 32.6% gems instead, which I ended up using for my rifle spear. I got a couple of lower tier blunt ones for the beast cutter, but not the ones I was looking for. So right away, there are two different ways you can handle this. You can either wait for those idiots to die of poison, because if you leave them alone, they'll just walk into that pool of poison over there and eventually die on their own. But that takes time, and it's not really very fast or efficient, so you can either go over there and kill them, or bypass them completely and come this way instead, which will have you dealing with just that one dog, whom you can shoot in his face and knock him down, and that the sack guy, the madman there, who he can't do anything to you because he's too slow and stupid. But this guy with the scythes here, he can. He's pretty dangerous. What you're going to want to do is get his attention, lure him away from the switch first, and then while he's chasing you around that cart, run up to the switch, pull it. He'll attack you, but your invincibility during the switch will protect you from the attack. From that point, you can either run back the way you came up those stairs, or you can do what I've done here, which is run out the door. This is a little bit riskier, but it is possible, and I wanted to show that it can be done without getting hit. Generally, though, it's a little bit safer, and in fact, probably actually a lot safer, to run back up the stairway with the kidnapper there. So, either way, you go over there, you pull the switch, and you don't even really need to use a bold hunter's mark, and in fact, you're probably not going to have time to anyway, because that madman with the scythe is going to chase you down too quickly for you to be able to. So, in this fight, you start off on the bottom level of the room rather than top. And unfortunately, that puts you at a bit of a disadvantage, because down here is much more open. There's not really a lot of cover you can use other than the pillars, and if you do use the pillars for cover, you can very easily end up getting trapped in a corner. So, what I recommend doing is lure all three of these idiots down here first, and then just run back up top. You can use the pillars over here for cover as well, and as long as you can dish out enough damage to these guys to kill them so quickly that the gun guy can't get close to you and trap you in a corner, you can pull off the fight down here, but you can see that even here, I ended up backing up into the stairwell because there's just more cover here, and it also helps funnel them so that they're all coming at you from the same direction. One of the worst things you can let happen to yourself in this fight is to let them surround you and come at you from more than one angle. So, best thing to do, especially if you're using the rifle spear, is to just funnel them into the stairways like this and time your attacks so that the pistol guy's shots either miss you or go right over your head, because that'll happen quite a bit in the stairway as well due to the elevation difference. This guy here is normally very easy to parry, but my timing was way off today for some reason. I missed it on him a couple of times and decided, you know what, screw it, there's no point. The Kirkhammer is also a very good weapon for this fight if you're using a strength build, but pretty nearly any weapon that has a good strong charge attack will work. Bear in mind though, if you're going to use charge attacks on these guys, you absolutely must use a weapon whose charge attack stuns them and breaks their super armor. Because if you end up having to trade hits with them and you don't break their super armor, you will take a very heavy hit and will probably get killed. So, this is exactly the sort of gem you'll probably be looking for from this fight. The physical damage plus 27.2% radial. And again, any of the normal gem types that can drop from this fight as radials can also drop as triangular or waning. So, if you want a triangular or waning physical damage plus 27.2% gem, you do get them from that fight, but you're going to be there a hell of a lot longer because they're much rarer drops, unfortunately. But let's say you've got Ludwig's rifle, upgraded a little bit, but you need, for example, a gem for it. You want one of those awesome 31.5% blood damage bonus gems, right? Well, this is the glyph you want to use to get that. It's Y592BYZA. This is probably the easiest farming run you're going to see today, partly because it's just a regular enemy you're fighting rather than a boss, but also partly because that enemy is not very far into the dungeon at all. So it's going to give you an East Gravestone dungeon, and you'll be noting already that this dungeon is also cursed. So you're going to have to be careful about your health in here. But with that said, you don't have to worry as much, because the enemies along the way, you can just run by them. They are just these two idiots, and they're not going to follow you for a great distance. There might also be somebody in one of these monster closets along the way, but they'll forget about you as soon as you cross this boundary. And after that, all you really have to worry about is the enemy that actually drops the gems, which is this guy. And again, it's just that dirtbag with the pistol. And as you can see, he's much, much easier to deal with when he doesn't have his dumbass butt buddies backing him up. The unfortunate thing here is that he usually drops ritual materials. And he can occasionally drop a blood-tinged scaling gem, which is just trash and you don't want it. So if he doesn't drop what you want, you just use a bold hunter's mark and do the run again, because he will respawn. I also, because he didn't drop it the first time, I have an opportunity to demonstrate dealing with him with the Whirligig Saw. And that, I think, is probably the most fun I've had dealing with the Watchers, because the Whirligig Saw chews those guys up big time. Another thing I should mention, and I wanted to mention this at the beginning when I showed my status screen, is that it is absolutely essential for you to stack every possible source of item discovery bonus you possibly can. So that means all three eye runes and the milkweed rune if you have it. And if you're on an arcane build and you've leveled up your arcane, so much the better. And here it is. This is the kind of gem you want. You want either generally the increases stamina cost curse, because that's completely irrelevant on a gun and has no effect at all, or the weapon durability curse, because that also has no effect on a gun. But what if you want to farm some materials to finish upgrading that Ludwig's rifle? Let's say you want some chunks, and you don't want to bash your head on the stupid scourge beasts in the Upper Cathedral Ward, and you don't want to spend 20 insight for one chunk, because let's face it, it's better than 30, but it's still a fucking ripoff. You use the glyph jemmjmpi, which once again will give you a cursed East Gravestone dungeon. But this time, we're going to be farming the first boss of the dungeon for Bloodstone chunks. Why is this better than any of the other options? Well, first of all, because the boss can drop up to 2 chunks at a time. So that's the equivalent now of 40 insight in, what, 2 or 3 minutes? And also, the boss is just a Brainsucker, so it is literally the easiest Chalice Dungeon non-boss ever. And you're going to see that very soon with the Whirligig Saw, but any weapon that has thrust damage is ideal for that as well. And I mean, even some that don't, but you guys know how to deal with that. Now be very careful here, don't go for that shiny, because this dungeon has a teleportation trap on the floor right in front of that item, and if you try and grab it, some messengers will show up, and they'll troll-a-lol warp you to some obscure corner of this dungeon with a bunch of, what do you call it? There's a witch there that summons those scythe-wielding minions you fight as part of the Witch of Hemwick boss battle. And again, the gems dropped by the switch guards here aren't really worth using, but the ones dropped by the boss, if you want that flat number of points of arcane damage, the boss does drop gems that are worth using in that regard. So you could look at that as maybe a secondary objective for this dungeon, of farming those gems. But the boss here can drop 1 to 2 bloodstone chunks, and it also has a far, far higher drop rate for those chunks than any of the other sources of them in the game. The werewolves in the Upper Cathedral Ward have something like a 5% chance-ish at best. This boss has, I believe, a 60 or 70% chance of dropping gems. Or the blood gems. God, bloodstone chunks, I'm sorry. He will usually drop some gems as well, but the chunks are about a 70% drop. And I think 70% on the first floor, the ones on later floors have higher chances. So, as you can see here, this is just a tier 17 gem, but you can get higher tier gems from this fight as well, and they will sometimes give you really good arcane point bonuses, flat point rates, as well. So, this is the best place to farm chunks, in my opinion, because, boom, we're done, we just got 2, and if you want more, you just delete the dungeon, create the dungeon again from the glyph, go kill that idiot again, and probably get at least 1, if maybe not 2 more. So, what do we do if we want to get that Ludwig's rifle to plus 10? We need a blood rock, right? Here's the glyph that we're going to use for that. It's YDKNSNH4. And as far as I know, this is the one that most everybody in the community uses. And you'll note that this gives us an East Gravestone dungeon which is not cursed. So at the very least, we have the benefit of not having to deal with a halved HP bar for this. Now, unfortunately, we do have to clear our way to the third floor of this dungeon in order to be able to get to the fight that drops the Blood Rock. But fortunately, the way there really is not too bad. So, for starters, we're just gonna head on in, light the lantern, and the layout here is a little bit trickier getting to the switch, but it's not too bad. Jump down off that bridge to the left, just ignore all the enemies on the way, you don't have to worry too much about them. When you come out of the tunnel, take another left. It'll bring you to a circular room. You've probably seen this room before if you've done any of the Chalice Dungeons before as well. I get lost in here a little bit trying to find the stairs, but usually they're to the left, depending on where you come in from. Be careful here, though, because when you start walking up the stairs, somebody up there will kick a boulder down at you and kill himself in the process, so once the boulder is safely passed, there's nothing for you to worry about. You just enter the first room on the right at the top of the stairs. Be careful, though, because there is a section of floor in the center of the room that will collapse if you step on it, and it'll dump you into a hallway that I think has a couple of enemies in it. And then through this door is the switch. So, you're off the guy guarding the switch. It is worth using a Bold Hunter's Mark here, because the walk back would otherwise be pretty annoying. But once that's done, you've got a very easy, straight run to the boss. Now, the first boss of this dungeon is a Keeper of the Old Lords. So, if you have a particular strategy that you like using on the Keeper, use it. If you've never really developed a good strategy for this boss, or if you've never fought the boss before because you're new to the Chalice Dungeons, then you might find it helpful to watch carefully as I show you the best MLG pro strat ever, which is a corner trap with the Whirligig Saw. There is absolutely nothing this guy can do to get out of it. And as you can see, 8,400 damage from that is not too shabby. I'm not really going to talk too much strat for this boss, though, because there are other people who probably have strategy videos up showing you better ways to beat it with weapons other than this. But I'm going to just take it on faith that you guys are capable of defeating this boss, because, I mean, how hard is it, really? Look at what an easy fight that... No, I'm sorry, that's... I shouldn't even joke. Now, the unfortunate thing about this dungeon is that because it is not cursed, the gems you get from it are going to be pretty worthless, so you'll end up throwing most, if not all, of them away. Probably all. Now, another comment I wanted to make while we're on our way to the next boss is regarding access to these dungeons in the first place. Some people have said, well, it's such a pain to get through the Chalice Dungeons to the point at which you can access these, but actually, it's not too bad. In order to get the chalices you need to meet the prerequisites for creating these glyphs, all you need to do is clear through the most of, anyway. I don't even think you really need to clear through all of them, but most of the developer layout dungeons from the chalices that you pick up in the normal game. There, I wanted to just show that little messenger there with the lantern. It's pretty handy. And I guess by that, I mean the non-root dungeons. You do not need to go through any of the root chalice dungeons to get the chalices you need. You just need to pick up the root chalices themselves. And the root chalices are all in the regular chalice dungeons. And then once you've got all the chalices you need, you just need to create one dungeon that has all three additional effects, rotted, feated, and cursed. Because once you do that, that will grant you access to any dungeon that has any combination of those effects. So if you're having trouble and you're getting a message when you try and create these glyphs that tells you you don't meet the prerequisites, you have to actually have the chalice for the dungeon that you're entering. And that means if you want to enter one of the random layout Cursed East Gravestone dungeons, then you need the Cursed East Root Chalice. You'll also need to have already created a dungeon with whatever additional effects the glyph dungeon has. So if you're trying to create a dungeon from a glyph, and the dungeon you're trying to create has rotted and cursed, then you need to have already made a dungeon of your own that has the rotted and cursed effect as well. So once again, this fight is just a brainsucker. And if you get hit with that from far enough away, it'll wear off before he has a chance to get to you. I was being a little careless here. I was trying to switch to the rifle spear, and I was screwing up my button inputs, and I ended up getting hit, but I wanted to demonstrate why the rifle spear is also a good weapon for this fight. And granted, I have three massive thrust damage bonus gems in this weapon, but still, I mean, look at this. There's nothing this guy can do as long as you don't let him hit you with that paralysis attack. So there we are. Plus, if you're trying to build up a weapon anyway, chances are you'll get some bloodstone chunks on the way down to floor 3. So it's always worth getting down to floor 3 in this dungeon first, so that you don't spend any unnecessary time farming bloodstone chunks in a different dungeon. Because chances are you'll get at least some of the ones you need just on the way down. Now, the third floor of this dungeon has a very interesting property, which is that it doesn't actually require us to go find a switch. The way this works probably has to do with the algorithm that they use to generate these dungeons, because it does sometimes cause some weirdness. So we're going to start off down here by lighting the lantern as always, and in the next room there is an elevator. That's what that central altar over there in the middle is. Be careful not to fall off the elevator and land underneath it, because there's a pit there, and getting back will be a bit of a pain. So you ride the elevator up, and if these guys are in the process of walking past this entrance here, wait for them to go by. It just makes things a lot easier on you. Walk past that first door on your left, and go into the second door here, which will be just about directly behind where you came in. None of the enemies on the way here matter, but there is a Scourge Beast in the hallway up ahead, whom you're going to have to be prepared for, because he hangs out right around the corner, and if you're not watching for him, he can get the jump on you. So deal with him, and if he drops a gem, don't even bother. I don't know why I picked this up, but because this isn't a cursed dungeon, all of the gems you're going to get here are really not worth carrying, so. Now here's the interesting bit. You open up this door, and we end up in one of those gigantic cavernous rooms that usually have a couple of undead giants with cannons just kind of sitting there. Walk right over here to the next door and get back out. Don't bother exploring that room, there's nothing useful in there. And anyway, the way that we need to go takes us this way. So you come out of here, you turn right, and boom! This puts us behind the door we would normally have to open with a switch. And now we can open it just manually. So there we go. And I do recommend you open this door, because if for some reason you do die to the boss, then you're going to want this convenience. You're not going to want to have to make that run all over again. Interesting as well that opening the door still does not change the lantern's color from purple to blue to indicate that the switch has been pulled. And here we are at the boss. So, before we talk about save scumming, one thing that I like to do for farming blood rocks here is to just enter the boss room first before I upload my data to either the cloud or my memory stick. Because this will just save us a little bit of time, especially if you have to re-download your data multiple times. Opening the door once before you do this in earnest will just prevent you from having to open the door every time you reload your data. So you open the door, open up your menu, quit to the title screen, and then hit the PS button. Bring up your PS menu, head on over to Settings. There are going to be a couple of options in Settings. You go down to, well, more than a couple, you go down to Application Save Data Management. You'll quit the game, and you'll see the top option here is Save Data in System Storage. You pick that. The two options below that, which are Save Data in Online Storage and Save Data on USB Drive, that's what you use to download your data if you should need to download it because you didn't get the item you wanted. So just follow the procedure here. copy your data to your USB drive or to your online storage. I like to use a USB drive because copying it back is usually much faster. Now, one thing to pay attention to here is you do not want to accidentally download data from online storage or your USB drive on top of your most recent data first. Because if you do that, then you lose your current save file and you go back to whatever state your data was in when you last saved it to either of those places. So be careful. You've been warned. So after you've saved your data to your backup location, you just load your game back up again and trap this idiot in a corner with the whirligig saw. And once he's dead, he either will drop a blood rock or some bloodstone chunks, or just nothing, or a worthless gem. Obviously, the bloodstone chunks are not what you want, so if you don't get the blood rock, as I did here, then just keep on opening up your PS menu and downloading your data that you saved in front of the boss room door, and fighting him until he does cough up a blood rock. So this is a lot easier, and even if you have to do it multiple times, it's still usually a lot faster than farming 60 insight. Now, if you do have 60 insight on hand and you don't need it for anything else, then yeah, absolutely, a blood rock is the best use for it. But otherwise, if you don't have 60 insight, then this is probably the easiest and best way of getting yourself a blood rock. And now we can finish upgrading our Ludwig's rifle. Now, for those of you who want a gem type I haven't shown here, or for those of you who want a Chalice Dungeon reward other than a gem, like if, for example, you want a rune or a lost or uncanny weapon, I'm going to put some links in the description to other resources, community sites where people are keeping a running chart of different locations where you can get those things. So there it is, everybody. I hope that this has answered the questions people were asking and that this is what everyone wanted. Thank you all for joining me, and good luck on your Chalice Dungeon farming runs. Take care, everybody.